heard the garage door close, so I got up to go see what was going on. And when I walked out to the garage, Caden was standing over the garbage can, and he turned and he looked at me and in like a really surprised tone said, "Mom, I accidentally cut myself." And I had walked over there, and you could see it wasn't an accidental cut. There was blood everywhere. He had a kitchen knife, a steak knife, not even a sharp knife, sitting in the trash can. And I grabbed his arm and walked into the sink, and I got some paper towels put on it. And I went and grabbed him a shirt and so that I could take him to the hospital. He pushed past me heading for the garage and saying, "I gotta get it out, I gotta get it out." And I was only seconds behind him, but I was at the trash can. I was there, but still, he had taken another chunk out of his arm with no hesitation whatsoever. The only way I got him to stop fighting with me was to tell him I would help him. I was gonna help him get it out. We were gonna take him, I was gonna take him to the hospital. They would help him get it out. We dropped the knife in the kitchen sink and grabbed some more paper towels on the way through. He was calm at that point, the entire ride, checking into the hospital.
We've been dealing with different phases of this for years. I mean, this is not like all brand new, you know. So, you know, I would come here to Medford for a week or so, and every night he'd be in the bathroom, in the shower, yelling and screaming and hitting the walls and hitting himself. And so, I mean, you know, we had known for a long time that, you know, but really all we could do for him was just make sure that he had a roof over his head. You know, we'd come and help him buy some food when we were here. You know, I mean, there was somebody here, either myself or Sherry, you know, at least every like, at least once a month. We kind of know his patterns pretty well because, you know, even though this was much more extreme than things that he had done in the past, so, you know, Sherry was trying to explain that stuff because you would think that somebody that's investigating his mental condition would be curious about the history of his mental condition. And she pretty much just shut Sherry down and said, "Oh, I've heard all this before." And, you know, really just wasn't interested in any of the history. It was like, well, this is where he's at right now, and this is what he's saying right now, and that's not enough.
They dropped the hold on day 3, and on day 4, he was trying to check himself out into Portland with no shoes, paper scrubs from the hospital, no phone, no money, no plan, no way. Nothing was making sense to the hospital for his plan to keep him safe. So they actually stopped him from checking himself out.
So really, there was a complete disconnect between the actions that the county was making and then the actions that, you know, the hospital felt should be done, that there was a complete disconnect there. So at that point, we realized that the only way that we were going to have any sort of control or real influence over his health care was for us to get guardianship, because, you know, he doesn't recognize that he has any sort of illness, you know, physical or mental, and then basically his level of communication is very, very low.